Sir, so, you know, I call him Sir because I attended his one of the sessions, a very informative and learning session. So, you know, whatever we learn from anyone becomes our guru. So, as such, you know, I'm quite honored to be introduced by one of my guru. Esteemed attendees of this program, I can see, you know, many of you sitting in the audience are leaders in some of the fields you work on. Can I ask, you know, how many are the leaders sitting in any position, your leading role in your organization? Wow, wonderful. One key issue of the leadership is the situation is the situation a leadership in the business? How many of you can agree that leadership is a situation in the business? That because of the leader, the company can go well or go bust. Of course, you know, in any language we speak, ye company achhi chalti hai. Our company sari chales hai. This company runs well, or this company doesn't run well. It's not the company who has the hands and legs to run. It's all boils down on the leadership. So, if leadership is the key essence of the business, then the solution is also you as a leader. In any business we operate, the vision flows top down. So if the leader has certain aspirations, certain vision, then he can take his team and the company to the next level. Let's say, you know, now you are the leader. So what are the requirements of a leader to maintain yourself or sustain yourself? The topic is, you are the only variable in the business is you as a leader. Now the opposite is how to sustain it. If you are such variable that if you are removed or you are changed, the company will change its performance top down and left, right and center. To sustain in the leadership role, there are certain fundamental requirements of a leader, and that makes you as a leader. Certain, many of you as sitting over here, what are the qualities required by a leader? Can we share it? You know, please. Enthusiastic, wonderful.
Visionary,
of course.
Team worker.
Wonderful, team worker. Of course, yes.
Lead by example.
Wonderful, lead by example.
Capacity to take decisions.
Wonderful, capacity to take decisions.
Integrity.
Wonderful, one of the basic requirements of today's environment in the business is integrity.
Nowadays it is required innovative attitude.
Very true, sir, very true. Most of the large companies are having an innovation cell or an innovation department in the company. Wonderful.
He should be inspirer and motivator.
Wonderful. You know, he should be inspirational. People should follow him as a leader.
Walk the talk.
Absolutely. You know, I cannot preach something which I am not practicing. So, you know, that's very important, to walk the talk.
Take a responsibility.
Of course, you know, he has to take the responsibility of the decision he has made. And a very classic example of this is in the initial stage in the ISRO, when ISRO was led by Honorable President APJ Abdul Kalam, and the mission failed. So he went to the press and addressed and accepted the failure. And when in the second attempt, when the ISRO got success in the program, it was his subordinate addressing the press. So, of course, taking the responsibility. Yes?
risk taking quality.
Of course, risk taking quality, because it has to be very calculated risk taking quality. That risk is a very subjective thing, because of course in the business we say higher the risk, higher the returns. But you know, in the real practical world in the business, every decisions are taken with calculated risk, because the only objective of the company is to sustain. Any wrong decision or any decision which is uncalculated can lead to disaster. Of course, few more.
Create more leaders.
Wonderful. This you know is a very essential requirement of a leadership quality to build a successor after him. Succession planning is so important. Many a time what happens is that a company has started with a very modest beginning and turned out into a large conglomerate. Now the most important duty of that leader, so far maybe it is a family run business, but then you know to create a successor to it. And many a times, not necessarily the first in the line. It's not and if you see the classic example of the Tata's hierarchy or the Tata's line of control from Jamshedji, it has never been the first in the line. It was the most competent person. So succession planning is one of the very key essential of this business.
Preparing a culture to work for the company in the best way.
Wonderful. You know, the culture is plays a very major role in the sustainability of the company. It all depends on what kind of culture you create in the company. Certain companies, people or employees are so proud to work with. Like, you know, they say, I'm a Tata employee, or a Marriott culture in the hotel industry. You know, they set certain norms and the standards and the culture of the workflow and the top down and even the horizontal is so defined and ethical that, you know, culture plays a very important role. Otherwise, you know, opposite of that, you see a company of 9,000 crore vanishing in no time. You know, a company having a 10,000 crore business were not seen next day. So, you know, the culture is a very, very important thing. Few more?
Sufficient cash flow.
Pardon?
Sufficient cash flow.
Of course. See, in the business, cash flow is very important. Cash flow plays, see, in the finance, of course, that's a typical part of the financial controller of the company. But if there is no healthy cash flow in the company, then company runs into a debt. And then what happens is you borrow money from one project to finish your previous project. So if the cash flow is not forcing properly, Gujarati mein apne sadhi bhasha mein kahiye to jitni chadar ho itla pag phailavana. Sometimes people take wild decisions and not maintaining the cash flow. The product is good. Their sales and marketing, everything is fine. But many a time they are out of cash to sustain for a certain period, and that becomes a cause of their failure. So you know, it's all like, you know, few adding to more to it, you have to be accountable. You know, as a leader, you are accountable to others. And it's always wonderfully said, it's led by example. And a leader plays as a missing link. People go to him for problem fixing, and at any point of time, he gets stuck. You know, a troubleshooting has been done by him. A very classic example of this is one of my very close friends. He's working in Oracle, and he's having almost about, so on a very high position. He has a contract with Oracle of $3 million annual contract. And he hardly goes to the office. And he tells me he's been paid for what he's knowing, not for what he's doing. So he is as a troubleshooter in the company, that as and when something gets stuck, you know, they are like airbags in the car. You pay for the airbags and pray it never comes in use. But when it comes in use, it saves our life. So it's a missing link. A leader plays very importantly in the company. Now, certain precautions what a leader has to take. Because as we talked about the positive sides of the leadership, there are always certain precautions which are required in the leadership role. And always you have to give credit to your team for work they have done. Anyone can give an example of a company or an experience where a team has done the work and the leader takes the credit. Many a times it happens. The team, with this kind of attitude, the team gets demoralized. As I gave you an example of Honorable President Abul Kalam, when the success came, you know, he passed it on to his team, that it's because of my good team, you know, we could succeed this. And this is, always you have to take upon your, whatever is the outcome of your decision, you have to take responsibility of it. One is giving credit, another is, you know, taking responsibility of your decision, may it be right or wrong. Normally what happens is, you know, if something goes wrong in the company, people look for just a shoulder to blame someone. So it should not be that, you know, it should be bold enough to say that, okay, this is where we made mistake and he is responsible, and corrective measures has to be done for that. And normally, you know, in many times you've seen that in communication is a biggest barrier. If lack of communication is the biggest barrier in the growth of the company. If you don't communicate well, you know, then you have all the ripple effects. In the business, it's not that no news is good news. You know, you have to communicate. A silence is not a healthy sign in the business. Communication of a leader with its subordinates is very, very important. And always, one has to maintain and see the emotion and the perspective of the other person. Because if something has to be told in which affects the team, it has to be presented in a way that you don't feel or hurt their emotions or their perspective. Of course, in the leadership role, it's always, you know, when you negotiate, it's either you convince me or get convinced. But even in this situation, a good leader always puts his perspective, keeping others, people's emotion intact, or doesn't hurt their emotions. And you know, these are certain things which, you know, a leader should take precaution of. These are all things what we are discussing, you know, to sustain your position as a leader. It is very easy to reach on the top, but it's difficult to sustain on it. Number one position, many company has touched, but after some time, you know, because of lack of many things, you know, they lost their position, or you know, it is a new lack of innovation, lack of leadership, or whatever, you know, it comes and they lost their position. We'll discuss some of the companies which has succeeded by changing their business model. Now, change of a business model always happens from the top, because strategies are designed on the top. The board of directors designs the strategy and passes it on to the CEO to execute it. But the strategies which are designed on the top are aligned with the ground reality. It's not, you know, they are done in isolation, that, you know, it doesn't convey the message to the bottom. And one of the most important ability of a good leader is that, you know, he dissipates his vision without diminishing its values. The vision and the mission statement are made fantastic. You know, they are made in the copper plate and hanged in the wall in most of the companies we go. Some of the companies we see, it's gathering dust, or nobody follows that vision and mission statement what the company has designed. A good leader, what he does is dissipating the vision to the lowest person in the company without diminishing its values. Normally, what happens is, like, you know, it's a Chinese whisper. You talk to the next person something, and by the time it rotates and come back, you know, it's a completely different thing. And miles away from the first person, you know, who has passed the message. in a good leadership role, you have to ensure that the dissipation of the vision is done without diminishing its values. One classic example I give you, while I was studying my PhD in leadership, I studied most of the leaders of the world, if not all. And one classic example I encountered and I came across was of the President JFK. When President JFK, of course, everyone knows that Russia is the first person to send man in space, and it became a credibility issue for America to maintain its space supremacy. So they came out with a project of a man on moon. So then this Apollo mission was launched by JFK. In the beginning years, when he went to for the inspection in NASA, he saw a man sweeping the floor. And JFK asked him, "What are you doing here?" The answer of that person can be written in stone in golden words. The person replied, the one who was sweeping the floor, he said, "Sir, I am helping sending man on moon." The act of every person in that program of Apollo was aligned to the vision of sending man on moon. He could have said, "I'm mopping the floor, I'm cleaning the floor, I'm sweeping the floor." This is a common answer we expect. His answer was, "I'm helping sending man on moon." So that what it says that, you know, all employees in our company are as important as the top person in the company. Of course, in my company, I always say that, you know, my office boy is one of the most important person in the company, because if he doesn't come, and you know, there is surely an unrest in the office as far as the housekeeping and other things which are concerned. So this is something, you know, which, and all employees in the company are like the organs of our body. See, learning can be taken from only two sources, as far as my knowledge is concerned, and it's my opinion, either from human body or from universe. These are the two sources where the entire knowledge, you can have learnings from these two sources. All the organs of the body are aligned and have their revolving importance. If I need to walk, my legs are important. If I need to eat, my hands are important. So every person is like an organ in the body which is important on the time it works, emerges. So you know, in many a time, they are complementing each other. Like if I walk with my legs, my hands automatically swings. There is a 1.5 feet distance between the hand and the leg, but it swings on its own to help the legs to move easier. So like that, in the organization, the leader always tries to align the positions and the people in such a way that they work in a very seamless and a harmonious way. In certain companies, we see that the workflow is so efficient that, you know, the work is accomplished without any hassle. And some companies we see that usne barabar nahi kiya isliye mujhe ye nahi hua. Sir, mujhe ye chahiye tha, wahan pe ye nahi tha. I didn't find this place. This man is not cooperating. Because of this person, I could not get my work done. This is all calibration and alignment issues a leader has to fix. And in this process, once the things are aligned, it will function in a very efficient way. If this alignment is not there, then I use the word like a Parkinson's disease, that the organs move on its own without any control from the mind. So it's moving, but not in the direction or the will of the mind. So it has to work according to the alignment of the mind and body. Certain changes, what certain companies bought, which made them accomplish leaps and bounds. See, PayPal, as we know, it's an online payment gateway. It was not designed for that. When it was made, it was one of the cryptography company, and they could not accomplish anything in the field where they entered. They changed, completely changed their business model in 2002, and later on, it became one of the most essential and the safe and the safest payment gateway. It was eventually bought by eBay for 1.5 billion dirhams. So our company had started with a very different vision, and when they realized that this thing is not working, Levanch, you know, the head of the PayPal, he changed the business model, and what we see today, the one very strong instrument in payment, especially in the international payment. Nowadays, of course, Paytm is quite common in India, but if you have to do an international payment, one of the very strong and the safe payment is PayPal, through which, you know, we can transact with the company abroad. One of the classic examples is Google. Google, when they started, you know, it was founded in 1998. And when it was started, they had no clear vision or perspective or a business plan. They were struggling in the beginning to soul search their presence in the area of digital world. Then in 2003, Google came out with AdWord program, and they realized that, you know, this advertisement online will help people to connect. And that program went on so well that in 2017 or 16, I feel, you know, compete.com rated it to be one of the best. And it's now one of the best search engine is Google. It is always said that, you know, if you don't know anything, ask Uncle Google, you know, you will get anything and everything on it. So this, the change in the strategy, bringing the AdWord program, helped Google achieve what they are today. The secret of change is to focus all your energy, not on fighting the old, but building the new. This is something, you know, which a leader always has to do. Many a time we spend all our energy in fighting the old thing and trying to fixing the old thing, and at one point of time we are out of energy and it gets lost. A leader always tries to fix it, tries to propose a way out. They act like a water. Water, if you try to block the way, it will try to find its own way out. So always, you know, they look for something in the new area. And nowadays, the product life cycle is so short that one has to keep the change. The cycle of change is always rotating so very fast. Of course, you know, one classic example is of Apple. We all know it was started in 1976. And in the initial years, Even the founder of Apple, Steve Jobs, you know, was removed from it, and the company. Thank you, sir. The company took its different route, and eventually, when Steve Jobs started Pixel was bought by Apple, and that's how, you know, he came back in 1996, he came back to Apple, and as an interim CEO, because it was the second attempt of his in the Apple. In 1997, he was made a permanent CEO. Now, at that point of time, what strategical differences he made in? They had 350 product lines in Apple. From that, you know, he bought down to almost 50. And from 50, he brought down to 10. So these are the 10 product lines we will focus on and work. And broadly, they work in the four areas of, they have iMac, iPad, iTunes, and iPhone. These are the four sectors where they are focusing on, and they are championing this. Many mobile companies, we see they have multiple product launch, and so many models are available in the market at one time. Apple comes out with only one model, but they are year by year doubling their sales. They have 100% sales increase year by year, year after year. And that's one company which I think near to reach $1 trillion mark or already reached $1 trillion mark. That's the first company. So, you know, it's not like they were earlier a grocery shop having so many things. Then they narrowed down and focused to 10 things which they will work upon and achieve excellence in all these products. That's how, you know, the reliability and the product sustainability comes into it. Another is of course, you know, Facebook was founded in 2004. 2004, when it was founded, it was meant for the high school students. And that time, Mark Zuckerberg, he realized that, you know, if I open this, it brought a big change it was started with the college student. And then, you know, he introduced to the high school students. And later on, one change, shift in the strategy was that any person above age of 13 with a valid email ID can have a Facebook account. So this small change brought such a drastic effect in the company that we know the value of the Facebook right now, and one of the richest person is Mark Zuckerberg. So this is what a leader does. You know, he creates something of such niche thing which distinguishes him with others. Of course, you know, there are new leaders in the audience. Once any new leader, he was once a follower, because everyone starts their journey from the small. Nobody is a born leader. Of course, he might possess the ingredients of a good leader, but he doesn't become a leader from his birth. In the journey, in the process, that values and that ingredients of or that capabilities of his excels out, and then he becomes a leader. So there are certain things, you know, maybe emerging leader or aspirational leader, maybe, you know, in the coming time, should keep in mind what they should do in the business to sustain the business. In this, you know, you identify the opportunity. Always, you know, a new leader, of course, has to gather intelligence, and they work upon things, you know, which is a new leader always. Many times, what happens is he comes from a follower league to a leader. So he has to completely change his mindset from the team member to a leader position. Because when he was performing in the team, his role and his perspectives were different. What he was deliverables were different. His deliverables were on his own. Objectives were on his own. KPIs and KRAs were on his own performance. Now, once he becomes a leader, he is thinking holistic about the entire company, and not only the company, about the customer, the client, the customer satisfaction. So everything has to be thought upon and put into program. There are certain things what great leaders always do. In this, you know, a great leader, he has a plan. He has always have a plan ready with him, as a plan A, plan B, plan C. That is strategies. See, there is a very good saying that, you know, you cannot enter into a war without a plan, but no plan works in war. So, as a business, as a great leader, one always has to have a strategy in place. Now, that strategy should not be that rigid. It has to have a flexibility and an area of calibration where, upon in the journey, it has to be calibrated, and as the flow further, you know, that can be changed and adopted to the situation. A great leader always, you know, exercises body and mind. It's not always for a great leader, it's always, you know, and nowadays we say that it's apart from his wealth management of the company, his personal health management is also very important. Because if he is not a good caretaker of his own health, then, you know, it's something, you know, the ripple effects can pass on to him. Can pass on to the masses. If you recall the era of 80s and 90s, it was said that Dhirubhai ne taava mein to share ki value down di jaye. So you know, as a leader, you know, he was looked upon in such a way that his minor things affecting him was affecting the company as well. So he should have a very good balance of mind and body. He should act as a mentor to the people. Always, you know, has always a hand, extended hand for help to his team. And that's where, you know, a good leader can communicate and fix things in his company. One great thing a good leader always does, he encourages courage. This is a very important thing. Normally what happens that we don't encourage enough courage in the team. The SOPs are so strictly binded that I have to come and do these things. There is no flexibility in that. There is no say of suggestions in that. Any improvement, nothing can be suggested. It's so fixed and I have to just follow that. Normally in the corporate culture, it is the clear SOPs are there and one coming to that position, he just follows that SOP. A great leader always have that room for improvement and he is a good listener and suggestions are always taken very healthy. See, we all know that the steam engine was not invented in a laboratory. It was invented in the kitchen. In our company, nobody is deprived from giving suggestions. Even my office boy can come and tell me anything in parameters of respect. I will listen to it. And some of the wonderful suggestions in our company has come from such levels where we cannot even imagine that, you know, such suggestions and such improvements can come from this level. So a good leader always communicates well and he's a good listener. Now, you know, we'll talk about some inspirational leaders who turned around their companies. There are, again, you know, when we talk of inspirational leader, one of the top name emerging is Steve Jobs. We all know from a company suffering to in losses in the early 90s, you know, turned out to be the biggest company in the world. And he is such an inspiration as a leader that, you know, his talk, his speech given in the Stanford University, I think, you know, most of, how many are aware of that speech, you know, stay hungry, stay foolish. Wonderful. You know, that speech itself is such a good food for thought that stay hungry and stay foolish. Stay hungry is you need to have an appetite for improvements in the company. Always strive for excellence. See, there is one very good thing is that every best thing in the world has a further scope of improvement. iPhone 1, when it was launched, it was a wonderful phone that time. But they didn't stop there. Bill improved, and you know, today, what we have is iPhone 10X, which is launched recently. And always the continuous evolution, same as with Samsung. This continuous improvement is required, is done in the company And as we, as I told you, every best thing in the world has further scope of improvement. Excellence is an ongoing process. It is never a destination. So today what we see is a dream. Tomorrow it can be a reality. In fact, I went in one of the AI symposium in Dubai, and since last 1 year, there are so many programs happening on AI, BI, IoT, blockchain, and all these things in Dubai, that I thought in one of the conference that my knowledge of emotional intelligence is going to get redundant in short time. Because emotional intelligence is not dealing with people. Very soon, we are all going to deal with machines. And in that program, in that symposium, one lady from, a Japanese lady stood up and said that there is a hotel fully functional in Japan where it is fully run by robots. Not a single employee in that hotel, not a single. It is fully run by robots. So what we dream right now, or what we aspire right now will be reality of tomorrow. So,
okay, we talked about.
There is another inspirational case study of Chrysler CEO, Lococo. Lococo, when he joined in 1979, the company was bleeding. Company was in a huge debt. And he had to plead to the Congress that time, and Congress bailed out this company with $1.5 billion in 79, which is worth almost $6 billion of today. So, and this federal government bailed out this company with $1.5 billion loan. Lococo restructured their company, renegotiated with all the vendors. They stopped, certain products which they were having, introduced some new products like their K car and minivan. Chrysler is a very famous brand of automobile for the minivans. If you have been to US, you find a lot of, about 50-60% of the cars are Chryslers. So, in no time, by correcting the strategy in 1982, the company was able to fully repay that loan. So the change of policy and change of a leadership in the company brought the company back in the blue. Same happened with Ed Witchcraft. He was CEO of General Motors. Earlier he was CEO of AT&T. And he retired in 2007, but he was lured by GM, General Motor, to come back and fix the problem of General Motor. It was at the verge of bankruptcy. And while coming, he did certain fundamental changes in the company. They were working on some projects, to compete with the Toyota model of Prius, which is a battery-run car. And that project failed so badly that they went into that, stopped that program, and came out with completely turned around products, where in 2016 or 17 they launched the biggest IPO in the world, which was of $23.1 billion. So the change in the policy as a leader always helps, and these are the classic examples of doing things which didn't work in a different way. See, if you keep doing things the same which you have done earlier, you are going to get the same results even in the future. So to have a different results, come out from the legacy problems, you should have a different perspective and approach to it. Then only the company can change. And this gentleman, when he was retired in 2007 from AT&T, looking at his capability and looking at his performance of the past, he was lured back to General Motor. So again, in the business, if this model doesn't work, the replacement on the top has to happen for the sustainability of the company. One classic example is of Marvel. Marvel, it was a toy company, toy-based company. Then they merged with the Marvel to have this this products for licensing for the media. In this, they focused on the licensing of the media products in and that went in as a great success, where recently in the near past, Marvel was bought by the Disney at almost $6 billion. So these are all case studies of the company where the change in leadership and the change in the strategy, it worked. If the strategy is not changed on the top, the results will not appear. The results will not be effective. Another classic example of changing strategy is Telling, Richard Telling, CEO of Harley Davidson. Harley Davidson again was entered into huge losses and failing in stake against Japanese motorcycle manufacturer like Honda and Suzuki and all. Then in 89, Richard turned around the company, focusing on quality, the big bikes, what America likes, and customer service. With this three correction, they were able to acquire 50% stake in the US market. So from a loss-making unit to come up with a 60% stake in the company, was a 50% stake in US market, was a great success. One of the example is that, even in India, a very famous bike, Royal Enfield, in 10-15 years back, they lost their market stake. Then they came out with a model which was more user-friendly. If anyone would have ridden Enfield earlier, it was a very difficult to ride bike. After that, the turnaround was, they made the bike, which is the current models, designed in a way which is quite user-friendly, and again took the large share in the market. So by this, the strategy plays a very important role. And as a leader, one has to have that open approach on looking things which are working on things which are working, and eliminating things which are not working. The many times what we do is, a leader does, when it fails, they try fixing the old problem and they don't get results from that. Continental Airline is another classic example. They were making a monthly loss of $55 million. When the CEO took place, Gordon came in and in 1994, every month Continental Airline was losing $55 million loss. Then he realized, when he came, he stopped certain unprofitable routes. Because airline company works on customer satisfaction, customer delightness. See, in certain customer satisfaction, there are certain stages where improvements in this area has happened. One first buzzword came was customer satisfaction. That you make your customer satisfied for what he is paying for. So I'm happy for what I'm paying, I'm getting enough for that payment, so I'm happy about it. It's a satisfied for. Then the word came is customer delight. You delight your customer by giving him something extra what he has not paid for. So the customer is delighted. If I go and buy something, and at the end of the deal, I get a chocolate extra, I'm happy, something which came to me out of surprise. Then, and now the buzzword is the customer devotion. The company, all the company who are in the service industry, works into the level where, the client, their customers are devoted to it. that brand. One classic example, I will give you two examples of local and international. The local example is Nirma. Nirma has a 45% market stake in India. Now imagine a country of 1.25 or 1.3 crores population having 45%. You are talking about 50, 60 crore people using Nirma on daily basis. To have that brand loyalty, to have that devotion towards that brand, certain villages you go, the grocery shop, if it doesn't have Nirma, they will say, Kaivandani, kapra kala dusu. Nirma ave there. So you know that kind of brand loyalty they built. So this is where, you know, in any service industry where is required. Another brand loyalty I will give example is of Emirates Airlines. There are certain people who always fly Emirates. They have devoted customer that they only fly alternate airline where Emirates is not flying. So that kind of attachment towards the brand has to happen, and that is only can only bought by a leader on the top. In Continental Airline, you know, he improved customer service and cancelled many routes where, you know, they were making loss. Earlier there were complaints of lost packages, delays, all this thing. Punctuality is one thing, you know, an airline industry has to follow, and I am a great admirer of punctuality in AMA. This is my fourth lecture I am delivering in AMA, and it has always started on dot. So this is where, you know, I salute, you know, AMA for this punctuality principles and practice. And airlines, now especially the low cost airline, when they have to have 60 or 70% of their time which has to be airborne. Some achieve 80% as well. So a flight coming from Dubai to Ahmedabad and turning back in 45 minutes, deplaning the passengers, getting down the baggages, loading the baggages, boarding the passengers, everything happens in 45 minutes, and in 45th minute, it's a pushback. So this kind of efficiency in deliverables, you know, the Continental Airline achieved and reducing their delays and all, and the result of that was that in 2 years time, of 55 million of their monthly losses, they were making 250 million profit on annual basis. So you know, this is a turnaround which a CEO bought by introducing a shift in the policy. The learning of, you know, in all these examples and case study what we give is changes in business strategy were not accidental. They were not accidental footnotes that, you know, it happened by accident and we were able to generate good profit. No, it was a well-designed strategy of the leader which bought these changes, and that changes resulted to their success. These changes that were made unlocked the new dimensions. See, many a time the changes leads to something very different, and like if we one of the changes, if we talk about the Reliance Industries, started as a textile manufacturer or textile industry, now it is into mainly known for oil and gas, petrochem, telecom, many fields. So they were the changes and the diversification at the right time took the company into leaps and bounds. All these changes requires foresightness and, you know, and taking, grabbing the future opportunities. See, opportunities are like, you know, thread in the sky. When you see lightning, it's a thread in the sky. When we see the lightning occurring in the sky, it's like it looks like a thread. In that thread, you have to pierce the needle. So nowadays, opportunities has to be taken in that quick way. So if you ponder on the opportunities, if you ponder and think on it, somebody else is going to grab it and he is going to make success out of it. So all these are the things which make a good leader and sustains the person in the leadership role. I gave you an example of the CEO of the Marvel. From 2005 until now, he is the CEO of the company. There are Steve Jobs. From 97, he was permanent CEO until the day he passed away. You know, so to have achieved such positions as a cornerstone in the company, one has to behave and one has to have this characteristics of a good leader, all the ingredients of this good leader where they can sustain. And certain things, you know, what we then their name becomes synonym to the company. When we talk of Tata, we think of JRD. When we think of Reliance, you know, we think of Dhirubhai. So certain names of the founder in Tata's, of course, the founder Jamshedji Tata, you know, when we think of it. But in the recent era, which was very long chaired by JRD, so JRD is more in the recent past. But of course, there is a day in Tata where all the Tata employees go to Jamshedpur and pay homage to Jamshedji, you know, as a founder of Tata Sons. By doing this, a person attached, you know, his name to the company in such a way that whenever a person looks upon that company, that name comes in our mind. Steve Jobs or Apple is a synonym to Apple. So with this, you know, in your current business, in your current leadership role, of course, look for something where you make an impact on things which will sustain in the long term. Sustainability is the only thing which every company works upon in the recent time. Earlier, there were no sustainability reports in the company. Now, it is one of the essential sustainability report, there is a department of sustainability where a group of people works towards it in the large organization, in the small organization. They empower or take these services from the external agency, and with this sustainability report, you know, they design their strategies of the future, they design the adaptability of their product and look for the new markets and all. With this, you know, I come to the end of my presentation. If we can have some time for Q&A.
Let me take the opportunity of the availability of Dr. Mustafa. He was telling me about punctuality, but that is expected to be as punctual as he had promised you, even more punctual, right? Which allows us a wonderful opportunity to be my voice. मैं टेक्नोलॉजी में तब तक विश्वास नहीं करूंगा जब तक मैं खाने को डाउनलोड नहीं कर सकता दिस गिव्स अ वंडरफुल अपॉर्चुनिटी टू हैव अ चैट विद डॉक्टर मुस्तफा टू थिंग्स दैट आई पिक्ड अप व्हिच आई मस्ट मेंशन एट दिस पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम लास्ट टाइम ओवर अ कप ऑफ टी व्हेन वी वर टॉकिंग ही सेड लीडरशिप इज अबाउट हैविंग द एबिलिटी टू सी द इनविजिबल being silent so that I can allow it to see me. The ability to see the invisible, which means developing a phenomenally good vision, number one. And the moment he talked about this, I was reminded of a share. I hope you will allow me to share it. He says, मैं खुद ही अपनी तलाश में हूँ, मेरा कोई रहनुमा नहीं है. वो क्या दिखाएंगे राह मुझको, जिन्हें खुद अपना पता नहीं है. Each of these organizations went through rough times. Each of the individuals was questioned. Each of them took some very painful decisions. Each one of them must have put comfort and comfort zones on one side. So each of those examples, I think, was a perfect, a gem of an example, each one of them. Ladies and gentlemen, I throw the house open to questions for Dr. Mustafa. We have about 10 minutes where I'm sure you'd like to ask him.
So my question is, when you think you have started to turn out your business, or it will be the way you have created and you are not continuing the legacy? So, or is that a particular time?
See, when any business starts with a very modest beginning, there are four stages in the business. One is in the business. In the business is when I started, you know, I am from Q to President, I am doing everything. Or I have some subordinates with me, but every small and big things touches me, you know, on day-to-day working of the company. In this way, it's always in the beginning is this way. And in that era, if you ask someone, they are extremely busy. Because everything they are looking into every minute detailing of the company. One has to evolve from this, from in the business, one has to come on the business. That is a very big shift, you know, from this league of in the business to on the business. Like you appoint a manager who manages the things and you overview from the top. This evolution has to happen. This is a natural evolution. If it doesn't happen, then you know the company becomes stagnant. It will have an organic growth, but that growth, earlier you get 10 people working with you, now you have 50. But all these 50 comes to you for every small and big thing. So you have to appoint a manager. So you are on the business. This being on the business, you have time for expansion, new products, visit, exhibitions, new markets, wherein you know, to have that liberty. Some people, if you have asked, you know, in the business, he will tell you, "Oh, I am very busy. So, what do? I have just cash for it." So he could not come out of it. He was very busy. Agreed. But if this evolution happens, every act, if a person does, you should think how someone can replace this act from me. With this attitude, you empower things. Others. Now, the second stage is on the business. The third stage is BOD. After establishing many branches and many this thing, opening in many territories, once you create a board of directors. Board of directors, what they do? They design strategies and you appoint a CEO to execute it. The word itself says chief executive officer. He executes things. You on the top design strategies and then empower the person to CEO to walk in. And the fourth and the most important role is out of business. Out of business is as important as starting a business. If out of business doesn't happen, what happens in this thing that you don't create a second line, you don't create a legacy. You don't create a succession, you don't have not done a succession plan. So when you don't do succession plan, you don't give up that position. Na bhara wagar to challenge nahi. So you know, with that attitude, one does not leave that position. So you have to create a succession plan, leave the position to your successor. Now leaving this position to your successor does not redundant your importance in the company. You can be as an advisor of the company, but this gives you time to do the good work you have thought in your life, in your journey of upward climb. You aspire to do some noble work, but the only constraint is time. So with this, you know, out of business, you do some good work. That's why, you know, this large organization have their foundations, which are run by the peers of that company, and that good work is passed to the masses.
Sir,
please.
Thank you, Doctor, for your great input. Happy to see you here. We met two times in Chamber of Commerce.
Of course, yes.
This is a temple of Goddess Lakshmi, and this is a temple of Goddess Saraswati. My question is that, it's a suggestion. Have you studied for the political leader for this kind of something? Because you must have traveled many countries and you must have some observation about the political leaders. You can share some comments on that. It is equally important for the country, no?
See, now it's very difficult to talk on political leadership.
I wish the fifth topic will be this one.
Maybe, you know, sometime in future. But, you know, it's very difficult to talk on political leadership because, you know, of many reasons. Ethics, of course, it is very subjective. Leadership, by definition, is very different in the political arena. Maybe, you know, sometime in future. But right now, I'm not capable of talking on political leadership. Sorry, you know that man, the gentleman. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. My question was similar to that. Sir, you have experience from UAE and Dubai. They have grown enormously in every field, including tourism. So, what is there? They have done magic, whether it is because of their crown prince, their king, or it is because of people. And if only it is because of their leaders, like king, what are their quality as a leader?
Very good question you asked, you know, because when my father went to Dubai in 1958, there was no water supply, no electricity. India was much advanced compared to UAE in that era of 58. We had our own airline, electricity in our house, telephones, automobiles and everything. There was not a single kilometer of tarmac road at that time in 1958. Water electricity started in 64. So I used to ask my father that what made you stay here for 6 years without basic amenities, wherein India was quite advanced at that time compared to UAE. So he used to tell me that, you know, we had a vision this place will grow. Now coming back to your question, the ruler of Dubai, current ruler of Dubai, Sheikh Mohammed, His Highness, he has written a book called My Vision. In that book he has described very nicely about how Dubai was built. And many of you must be knowing the world's largest man-made port is Jebel Ali. Jebel Ali is the world's largest man-made port. It's built in desert and it can anchor 80 large-sized vessels at a time. So this port, when His Highness Sheikh Rashid, father of the current ruler, when he was building in the 70s, you know, in the late 70s when he started this, so people were very naive on their thought process, and they approached the current ruler, who was one of the princes at that time, quite young prince, that, you know, please stop your father, you know, what he is doing. He is emptying the treasury of the state by building such a port. Our current port is not fully utilized. So, you know, this world largest port, where will it serve? So, you know, His Highness Sheikh Mohammed, in his book, he mentioned that I was also too naive to ask question to my father, that, you know, why are you doing this? Because every morning he used to go and visit this site. So his father didn't reply at His Highness Sheikh Rashid that time. Then while driving back in the car, he told his son, Sheikh Mohammed Prince that time, the current ruler of Dubai, that my son, I didn't want to answer that time, because I didn't want the engineers to hear, to listen to my answer that time. There will be a day you will have a necessity of this port, and at that time you will not be able to afford it. So I am building it for you and giving you. So that was a great example of a vision.
Foresight.
Sir, you know, I will tell you certain things about Dubai, what you are talking about magic. There is no magic, you know, in Dubai. But, you know, it's a clear result of vision and translating and dissipation of vision. Everybody knows Dubai is a desert, right? So in desert, anybody from construction industry over here or doing any construction? Okay. Even if that not in, we know the logic that you need a bedrock for your foundation. अपने पायों को दिए ना अपने कहिए. तो इमाम पची bedrock पर the piles are resting. Now there are no bedrocks in Dubai. So it's pure desert. You dig, keep digging, and eventually water will come. You will not find any rock. In such situation, in such topography, you cannot, it's very difficult to build tall buildings. He built the world's tallest building. Dubai, everyone knows, 8 months is scorching heat. In such kind of weather condition, you cannot have good tourism. But he made the world's best tourist destination. Dubai is, if you see the geography of the Dubai, it be surrounded by very disturbed areas, politically also and otherwise also. So in such disturbed political surrounding, you cannot have an economic hub. He made the world's best economic hub, the business hub where people around the world gather to do business. So, you know, it is now defying the logic, and this happened only because of the vision. And as I told sir, you know, and sir told over here, he saw the vision is all seeing the invisible. We go and saw the desert, he saw a beautiful emerging city out of it. So this is, you know, the leadership and the vision. So,
yes. Last two questions. Yeah. We'll take two questions because AMA also has a closing time.
Yes, sir.
We discussed the qualities of the leaders in the great depth. Some of the industries, say like airline industry, we had beautiful airlines like Kingfisher, vanished. They had very good managers, top managers, and thinkers who worked on the policies and implemented in a long time, but vanished now. Say another best, Jet Airlines, which was working well for a few months back, but now in difficulty nowadays, could not pay the salary of this month. Now, though with experience, nice leadership quality of the persons who started and maintained, still they fail. I mean, what thing you see in this?
Sir, actually, see, to run an airline, how to run an airline to Jet, we cannot teach them because they are champions of running an airline. So this is not something we can teach them how to run an airline. But of course, yes, what an outsider or a third eye can do is show them the improvements, the areas of improvements. I'll give an example, sir, that we have accountants in our company. It's not that we distrust our accountant, that's why we have auditors at the end of the year. It's not that way. If you don't trust our accountant, on first instance, they will not be in our company. The auditors comes in a year and identifies in 10 days, these are the mistakes. You need to correct it. Where the accountant was seeing it every day, he could not realize that mistakes. It was not that Akbar was stupid that he needed Birbal. It was not that the Chandragupta was not capable that he needed Chanakya. Always there are advisors are required for every industry to give them a perspective, outside perspective, and correct certain things where an operator or an insider will never realize to improve. That's why nowadays we see that, you know, all the large companies have an advisory board. Very recently, I am honored to be part of one of the advisory board of a mega industry in India. So, you know, this is something where an outside perspective can give you an honest advice which can change things.
Dr. Mustafa, you have given a wonderful lecture on this leadership and everything. I can add on to that, Dubal is the prestigious company in Dubai. They don't have neither bauxite nor aluminum, but they are producing aluminum. They are the biggest producer of aluminum there. I've been there. One of the, I was from the engineering site back then, there, and doing some engineering work on them. So one of the partner, one of the contractor told me that I am the partner to the Dubai. This was the great culture which I used it in my next project of RAK based alumna project in Vishakha. All the contractors were the partner to the Dubai.
Yeah, because you know.
Second thing, I'm going to add it. You have got Pioneer Cement there.
Yes.
I was involved in keeping that sustainable environment. When the people from their place, who was trained in England for the environment, he told that these are all my people. I have to give them a best environment, better. And they got the award for this best environmental sustainable cement plant.
Wonderful. Sir, you have two questions. Your two questions, I will give a very brief, you know, answer on both of this. As you mentioned about Dubal, Dubal is the largest producer of aluminum ingots in Asia itself, if not in the world. it was number two earlier compared to Alba. Now it has become number one. Alba is aluminum bar end, and then it Duval to core. I'll give an example of this. This Duval, as sir has mentioned about Duval. PwC few years back, and the plant of Duval is you start from here and you reach to Kalapur station. It is Duval. It is about 15-20 kilometers. Kilometers, that plant is so huge, you cannot walk in that plant, you need to drive. They are champions of aluminum. Nobody can teach them how to process aluminum. PwC, a few years back, came and told them that, see, you know, we have studied your process. If you do some corrections, you will save X million dollars every year. And if I'm not mistaken, it was around $28 million every year. The first reply of the CFO happened to be our good friend, and he revealed me this, that you know, if that saving would be there, we could have seen it, because it's our own baby. So we could have seen this such a huge saving if it was there. But of course, when PwC, one of the top ranking auditors in the world, and the process creators in the world, when they say something, it has a lot of value and weightage on it. So there was a agreement on some certain percentage on saving which the PwC will get upon success. When they completed the processes, restructuring the processes, Duval saved four times of the projected figure. Four times. So, you know, that means you are talking about $70-80 million. Were the additional savings were done because of this, the restructuring of the processes and systems in the company. So this is where, you know, a perspective comes into place. Second thing, what you talked about, sir, is about the environment. Of course, pioneer cement and the environment.
The world.
Sir, you know, it's very important that there are four W's and one H. Why, what, where, when, and how. People pay very less attention on why they are doing this. Steve Jobs was able to create Apple of such magnitude company. He always used to question, why am I doing this? That why will answer a lot of answer, will the why question will answer, give answer to environment, sustainability, so many things that will create an impact in the society. So, you know, in everyone's, you know, journey in your excellence or whatever professional work you're doing, even in leadership role or in the support to leadership role, should ask it, why am I doing this? Is it creating any difference in the society? It is creating any impact? Is there any socio-economic impact of my act? And that will create or give birth to a sustainable company. Certain companies, what we look upon, you know, they pay a huge portion of their revenue on creating good things. May it be schools, may it be environmental, may it be planting trees and all. So, you know, that why has to be answered in a humanity way, and has to be done that it affects and impacts the masses at large.
Thank you very much. For a wonderful and very insightful talk, and for the deft handling of all these questions. There's so many insight. I think it's given you a lot of food for thought. It's also time for food, I think. So, by thanking you, we could have gone on longer, but we also honor the commitments in terms of time. Let me take this opportunity as a token of our appreciation on behalf of AMA to present a small, very, very small gesture from our side. Thank you, sir. Thank you.